President, ladies and gentlemen, B'nai B'rith means a great deal to me, and I've always been happy to me over 50 years ago. 50 years ago, in addition to this, things were very rough at that time, and I didn't have tuition for my last semester at school.
A defender of all against bigotry, anti-Semitism, racism, and all those issues. And I must say to you, I'd like to read a little article in this article.
Four years ago, Al Spiegel made remarks, a couple other.
Now, for the last point, let me say this. And you remember that racism, Zionism, equates with racism. There hasn't been anything which his enemies has not said.
President of the United States.
Your efforts today, our country has a bigger heart, a deeper sense of the generosity of spirit that must always define America. And on behalf of all Americans, I thank you.
We made together during these past 4 years. Once again, I want to talk about American policy toward Israel, today's new policy of deepened friendship and strengthened support. But first, permit me to share with you my view of how, working together, the American people have replaced our own nation's descent into impotence and despair with the rebirth of freedom, prosperity, and hope. Our country had faced since the Great Depression. In foreign affairs, we had lost the respect of friend and foe alike, and our willpower had grown weak and soft, undermining commitments to allies like Israel. Our leaders seemed to have lost faith in the American people and in America's future. They spoke of a national malaise. The States of America reached such a pathetic state of apparent impotence. But today, just 4 years later, we're seeing not humiliation, our accomplishments and ourselves. On the economic front, that's been vigorous economic expansion is taking up. Our tax rate reductions have restored incentives to the American people, and when tax indexes and about the tragedy that befell. But let me read you Isaac's own words. Nicaraguan Jews never encountered anti-Semitism until the Sandinistas. What the Nicaraguan people did in Nicaragua will be done by the Palestinians. Well, today, some in our national life would have America take a position of weakness in Central America. Or we stand four square on the side of human liberty. I pledge to you that we will maintain the deaths of millions in Cambodia or the travail of the Mosquito Indians in Nicaragua. I know that B'nai B'rith has been among the most concerned of the groups advocating American support for the Genocide Convention. Soviet threat to our mutual interests in the Middle East. Recent Israeli manufactured radios, remotely piloted vehicles, anti-tank. rate of some 10%. This free trade agreement will make our friendship stronger than at any time in the history of our two nations. Indeed, Prime Minister Shamir recently described American-Israeli relations.
Our continuing labors. And let me assure you, we will never attempt to impose a solution on Israel, nor will we. Be energized. God bless you all.
presidential today, and I want to take a moment merely on your behalf to express to him our heart.
Thank you. Okay, now, you want to join them, please?
Okay. Be glad.
Just stay right here. I'll hand on the hand.
Okay.
Get closer in with the president.
No, that's all right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, voters in the United States of America, I would like to present you with your own personalized vote.
Well, thank you very much.
We'll open it up here.
That's what
well,
I
was doing. Well, we've got them so you can go either way.
You should have heard the razzing. I will protect the press.
So. Hey, hopefully you'll have no more
following the ball down. He handled it very well, by the way. He handled it very well.
Yes. Probably got more mileage out of that than all the campaigning. The way bowling, what is it, Seth? How many million did you say?
70 million here in the United States bowl.
Thank you so much.
And we have memberships combined of 8 million, and the juniors have 750 to 800,000. So out of our offices in Milwaukee, we service nearly 9 million people.
And on behalf of the 4 million that belong to the Women's International Bowling Congress, and I'm sorry Mrs. Reagan couldn't be with us, we'd like to present her with an honorary membership.
Thank you
very much. Into the Women's International Bowling Congress.
Well, she's in Oregon right
now.
Oh,
well, I'm sorry she's not here.
With some of the youth drug programs.
Oh, yes. But also, there is a full set of equipment for her and for Mrs. Bush over in the other building.
Well, thank you very much.
And now, no excuse not to go bowling. Okay. I know you have nothing else to do for the next how many months?
Well, up at Camp David, there's a bowling.
Yes, we know. We'll expect to see you get off the helicopter with them in your hand.
I should confess something, too, though, that some years ago I was invited to MC a dinner that was
some bowling awards and things were being given out in Los Angeles that came back in my previous life. As
a I see.
And my opening line was to tell him that you usually tried to associate your being there with some connection with the sport. And I said, the only connection I can find is that my score in both bowling and golf, I'm still trying to break 90.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Well, Mr. President, I also have an honorary lifetime membership, but this one is for you, and that's from the American Bowling Congress, and we extend it with our 4 million members. Congratulations. Well,
thank you very much.
Welcome. Our pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Next time I'll try to be better. No shoe. Thank you. Well, we're
there. Written questions, and I will provide them to them after this session. Then they will ask you why, at this point, in your head, you didn't just quit, and they'll follow that up by asking you, are you going to conduct a low-profile campaign?
All right.
This is Andrew Neal.
Mr. President, oh, nice to see you. Nice to see you indeed.
This is our Washington correspondent.
Hi, how are you?
We had, I have a message from you. We were called to speak to the Prime Minister. She sent her regards.
Well, if you have the opportunity, please give her my...
She's rather busy these days. A bit busier than you, have to
say. Yes, yes. I think we're supposed to come over here and act like we're working.
Right.
Thank you.
This seat here, Mr. President?
Yes.
Okay. Good of you to make the time.
Thank you very much.
That's kind of it. Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. You know, my first visit to England was back in 1948, over to make the Hasty Art. And in those days, I preferred traveling on the surface, so I took the Britannia.
A little bit slower than the Concorde.
What?
A little bit slower than Concorde.
Yes. And in fact, I understand it was a 7 day, but we had to leave from up in Nova Scotia because there was a dock strike in New York.
It wasn't in England.
On the ship going over, I became acquainted with a member of the London Times, Tommy Thompson.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
And it was a small group up as sort of used to get together on a virtually daily basis. Ship's bar.
I know.
And I was quite taken with him. He was quite a...
Yes. He's quite a character. Are you all geared up for the campaign?
Yes, although I know what it's going to be like because I've had one experience as governor of California running for re-election, but you have to be governor at the same time.
Yes.
You have to do the job too with campaigns. So won't exactly be the kind where you go out on extended tours as it was 4 years ago.
And the unforeseen can happen, too.
Yes.
But you are so far ahead. Are we seeing a sea change in American politics?
I'm not going to be tempted by those. I'm worried, as a matter of fact, that maybe too many people are going to get complacent and think their votes aren't needed.
And not so now.
I keep remembering a Republican candidate named Dewey.
So you think there's a danger of getting too overconfident, perhaps, with such a leader?
Well, not for me. I never was that way when I was in sports and athletics. I always figure, as I put it, I'm going to run one vote behind.
Why do you think Mrs. Thatcher got re-elected last year on policies not too different from yours? Seen the election in Canada, you're way ahead in the polls. What's happening?
Well, I think I won't speak for another country, I'll speak for my own. I think there has been a growing awareness on the part of people in both parties here that the increase in government and in government intervention in what had traditionally been the private sector and so forth is finally catching up with us. The people have found that the cost of government has skyrocketed and that there are things that government cannot do as well as the private sector. I think this is what we're seeing. I think here in our own country, we came to a point in which the government's relationship with its own business and industrial community was adversarial, rather than
working together.
Cooperative, yes. And there seems to have been quite a reaction to that once we started to turn it around. And the debate for these last 3.5 years, that for about 50 years had been one of, well, how much are we going to spend on this program and that program, and what new programs? Suddenly the debate for these last 4 years, it turns out, has been how much can we cut the spending?
So the debate's on your terms now?
Yes.
I mean, you've changed to that extent, but it's you setting the agenda.
Yes. But I think in a way the people determine that also.
When you, if you get re-elected, not when, if, what's going to be your major priority on the international scene? I think that's what people
on the international scene, well, it has to be peace and it has to be reduced arms, particularly in the strategic field. I have to believe that if we can persuade the Soviet Union to join in reducing those weapons, that perhaps we can all see the wisdom of not only reducing them, but eliminating them. I don't think the world should have to live with this threat hanging over it. And it really doesn't make any sense. Every weapon that's ever been introduced until this one has had a defensive limit that has followed. And you could look at war as winnable or losable in the normal sense. But we've come to a point now that a previous president of ours, Dwight Eisenhower, said might happen. Come to a point where a war with the weapons now at hand, there is no foreseeing of victory or defeat in the traditional terms. The weapons are capable of destroying mankind and civilization. And when that time comes, as he himself said then it's time for the nations to sit down and find a better way of settling disputes.
Andrew, on that note, I think we're just about used up our time.
Okay. I hope, Mr. President, in another administration, that the kind of fissures that have been growing between Western Europe and the United States will not get deeper. There sometimes seems to be trends in the 1980s that are pulling us a bit apart.
Well, my feeling is that, yes, that I came in and inherited such a situation. But I believe that these summit meetings that we've been having, I believe that has been changed. I don't think we've ever been closer to our NATO partners than we are now. And Margaret Thatcher's had a great deal to do with that. I've got to take a second to tell you one thing. When we had the summit at Williamsburg, which was, and the first dinner, the first night, the heads of state, we all met at the, and dined at the, what had been the British colonial governor's mansion. So I was all set for it. And I was waiting until we were all settled, and then my line was going to be, Margaret, if one of your predecessors had been a little more clever, you would be hosting this gathering. So it all worked that way, and I started. I said, Margaret, if one of your predecessors had been a little more clever, she said, I know, I would have been hosting this gathering. Yes, she said,
she's
the line.
She's quick.
She really is.
Mr. President, thank you very much for seeing us.
Well, it's good to see you.
Thank you very much.
It's good to see you looking so
long. Well, I feel good.
Okay.
I'm Bill Hughes, a businessman.
Well,
good to see you. And James Bray.
Well, good to see you.
Good to see you.
An honor.
Nice to see you.
Jill Bobby, Mr.
President. Come on, Marshall Brown.
Good to see you, sir. It's good to see you.
We certainly appreciate you, James. So he's standing in there and they just run them in games all day. And he's asking for 4 more years of that. I'm tired.
Well, sometimes it's the most fun.
Well, it could be, right. But anyway, we're glad for you. I want you to know that.
Well, thank really you are. Very much.
We'll do it 4 more years, by God.
Might even change the 22nd Amendment by the time we finish that.
Well, no, I'm most grateful.
Well, we Clayton here. We brought you something back. I just want to play when you have a spare time, if indeed you have a spare time.
Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome. You sure are. Yeah.
Souvenirs here.
Super.
Thank you, sir.
Terrific.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
You get Dave.
Sure. Seal on it. That's great. One that's up there.